share the screen. Is the screen visible now?
Yes, it's clear, sir.
Yes, sir, it is.
How many people have come now?
Sir, 92 participants have joined, sir. I think we can start in another 2 minutes.
Okay, done.
Very good evening to all. Welcome to the fifth session of webinar Clinical Diaries, hosted by HMC Student Council. I will hand over Sai Kiran Ragam for inauguration session of the webinar. Over to you, Sai Kiran.
Good evening, one and all. Welcome to the fifth session of webinar Clinical Diaries, hosted by Student Council of Ados Homeopathic Medical College. On this occasion, I would like to welcome our today's speaker, Dr. S. Praveen Kumar, ex-principal and professor of JSPS, Government Homeopathic Medical College, Hyderabad, trustee and PRO of Global Homeopathic Foundation, presently professor at GIMS Homeopathic Medical College, Hyderabad. I would also welcome Dr. Praveen sir, Dr. Roshan sir, and Dr. Pagnam. Without wasting much time, I hand over to you, Praveen sir.
Very good. Good evening, all the people, all the friends. Dr. Roshan, Dr. Praveen Raj, good evening. I'm very happy to have come on to the screen, connected with your college. Once again, this is virtual meeting. Earlier, in fact, I was there along with my wife in your college. Today, our topic of discussion is homeopathic management of GIT disorders, gastrointestinal tract disorders. We all know that the GIT starts from mouth to the anus. So anything, everything can occur. And most of the problems are because of GIT problems or what we eat, what we cannot digest. That is a major problem. Now, big question, as our friend Sai Kiran or Dr. Praveen Raj, they asked, what is our role as homeopath? Day in and day out, we get lots of cases connected to GIT disorders. Whether it is just a simple stomatitis, glossitis, stomatitis for that matter. Just now I have seen one case, severe candidial stomatitis. Just severe. Just 15 minutes back I came home. So that case is RVD case, retroviral disorder. And we all know HIV infection causes severe stomatitis. Now we are not just dealing with a GIT disorder. We are dealing with a systemic infection with HIV, and that produces as a complication, as a problem, oral candidiasis, which is very common. So what are we treating? As Hahnemann rightly put it in third aphorism, a homeopathic physician must have the knowledge of medicine, knowledge of disease, knowledge of application of one to the other. Now that is very important. So when we want to apply the knowledge of disease, we should have been completely equipped with the knowledge of disease. What are all the conditions which affect the gastrointestinal tract? Because that is the problem in question today. And how it can be treated. And you all please recollect, I am told that you are all final year people or internees, whoever it may be, and you are well versed with it. So when we deal with such a case, any disease for that matter, we need to understand comprehensively what is the underlying cause, what is the pathology, what is happening here, and what is being expressed outwardly. This is very important. It is not just the expression, it is not just the etiology, it is not just the pathology. It is the conglomeration of everything, including even the family history, past history, everything. So now let us move forward. Let's see one case here. Now, a man aged 36 years, medical representative, was complaining of burning behind the sternum. हार्ट बर्न, दिल जलता है तो जलने दो, दिल जलना, हार्ट बर्न. सर्वर वाटर ब्रैश, वाटर कमिंग इन टू द माउथ, एरेक्टेशंस सिंस 6 months with occasional vomiting, and he had antacids without any relief. He's a medical rep. Nothing abnormality detected on endoscopy, and it was diagnosed as acid peptic disorder. This looks simple, but you should ask the person who suffers how painful, how problematic is it. He can't sleep, he can't eat, he's apprehensive, he vomits, he has all the problems. So that was the problem. Now this gentleman, when he came with these problems, pain ameliorated by drinking cold drinks, cool drinks rather, vomiting after food, no other modalities of pain, all the symptoms are masked due to irregular medications. He used to pop up Jellicil, Digine, Tan-40, Pandi, whatever is it, whatever comes in the way, because it is free for him. He is a medical rep. So first prescription, thermal modality, polite nature, phosphorus. All of you would agree, I believe. Phosphorus, burning behind the sternum, drinking cold water gives relief. Cool drink gives relief. You can go a little further in phosphorus. Phosphorus patient takes cool water, but the moment it touches the stomach mucosa and the contents in the stomach, when it becomes warm, it is vomited out. It is not there in this gentleman. Probably that could be the reason why the drug did not work. Now, we went into the life situation because it did not work. His father died at young age of this gentleman in an accident. This man took the responsibility of family at early age. This burden killed his desire to become a doctor. Whenever you see an interview of an actor, what does she say? I wanted to be a doctor, but I became an actor. Right? So here also, this man wanted to become a doctor, but because of the responsibility of his family, he was forced to settle as medical rep, got married late after fulfilling all his responsibilities. His sisters were to be married. By person, he is emotionally sensitive. Whenever he used to watch a sad situation in any of the media, maybe TV, maybe YouTube or movie, anything, he used to weep uncontrollably. There is one movie, his sister was explaining to me, one movie, Alluri Sita Ramaraju, whether it came in Kannada or not, how many of you have watched, I don't know. This was in Telugu. And one of the actress's son was cut by an English soldier, deliberately. That scene when this gentleman saw in the movie, the sisters had to pull him out of the theater and had to come out and come home. That was an embarrassing situation. So they used to tease for this. Now you see, I keep using Murphy repertory on table, very less often anyway, repertory. Horrible things, sad stories affect him profoundly. All the rest of the personality, remember, I'm not ignoring the rest of the personality. A soft-spoken person taking up the whole responsibility, he took up. So we have selected a remedy, and of course the family history as well. And then we gave that in 1 ml. And his regular food habits, of course, this goes without saying, we have to tell the food as well. We have to make a little change in his lifestyle and a little physical exercise. When he came next time, he was completely better. And no more pain, no problem, appetite improved, everything better. Now, the question to all of you, please, friends, tell me what was the drug? Am I audible? The question, is it audible? What was the drug given to this gentleman? Anybody? Yes, no problem. I have given phosphorus, but that was changed because I felt it was not a correct remedy. it was not yielding a good result. No voice?
Sir, as a participant has been muted to reduce the background sound, so they are putting their answers in the chat box.
Oh, that's good. Then I should see the chat box?
In the chat box, sir.
Oh,
yes, sir, yes, sir.
No, can you see and tell me then? That there is no chat box here?
Okay, sir.
You can tell me the answers without name anyway.
Sir, one answer.
One answer?
Sir, suggestion, sir, Natramure.
One?
Natramure.
Right. It is not correct anyway. Pulsatilla.
Aurometallicum.
Then?
Metallicum.
Yeah, I understand. That's it. Now there is one drug which has all the qualities and which has all these drugs in its pocket. That is carcinosin. Carcinosin is polite. Carcinosin is similar to phosphorus in temperament mentality. Carcinosin is highly responsible. Carcinosin will have all acidity symptoms. Carcinosin is ameliorated by drinking cold water. So, this gentleman was given carcinosin 1 mL and he became completely all right. That was one such case, GIT problem. Now, let's move to second problem. That was only symptom-wise treatment basing on his life space, taking the whole constitution into cognizance and treat the gentleman, he would be completely cured, which is, of course, ultimate aim in many cases. We may fail in some cases. Now, 53-year-old district forest officer in the lower district came with bleeding per rectum since 1 year, which was red and it was more before the stool and also some blood mixed with the stool. Cutting pain in the rectum, aggravation morning, ineffectual urge for the stool and difficult to pass the stool. Past history typhoid and personal history sleep disturbed due to discomfort in the abdomen. Aversion to sweets since the illness, please mark it. There is a change in disposition. All of you, my friends, you should remember what is the state of an individual, what is the disposition or the symptom of an individual. State, for example, I love sweets, that is my state. But when I become sick, I have fever. Now I hate sweets. Hating sweets becomes my symptom. Loving sweets is my state. That is my quality. I'm born with it. You read H.A. Roberts' Constitution and Temperament. My constitution, my temperament cannot be completely altered. But it would be modified a little depending on various factors. Right? Here, coming back to this case, aversion to sweets since the illness because it was causing severe inconvenience. And obese personality, chilly patient, family history, father, hypertension. On examination, tongue, mild white coated. Heart and lungs, nothing. Abdomen distended. Diagnosis, colitis. You can see the report also. We will show the report. Colitis with ulceration. Nux vomica, sulfur, ratania, kurchi, merkar were already used by the patient earlier, taking from one homeopathic physician at Tirupati. Now, let us understand this gentleman a little further. Because if you see, what am I trying to tell you here? If you go by just a symptomatology, you may be misled completely in certain chronic conditions. You have to take the whole constitution into cognizance. His past history, personal history, family history, his temperament, his constitution, everything. So let us understand him a little further. When we have understood completely, what are all the rubrics we got? Obese, chilly, aversion to sweets, blood per rectum, burning anus, difficult to pass stool, ineffectual urge, cutting pain in the rectum, tongue white coated. These were already there. So we have done the repertorization, understood him a little. then graph 0 by 1, graphites 0 by 1, daily 1. Chili, obese, aversion to sweets, these are his higher generals and other symptoms, they are also covered by graphites. Otherwise you would think maybe sulfur. Sulfur is in third grade in repertory for aversion to sweets. We may go for it. So I forced him to go for colonoscopy at the same institute at Chennai. And this is the earlier report before the treatment. Colitis with ulceration. Is it clear? Colitis with ulceration on 7th August 2010, Vijaya Health Center. And same place, 16th October 2010, normal. The ulceration has healed, inflammation has come down, everything, graphites 0 by 1, nothing else. So we can treat such cases with a constitutional remedy in different types of potencies, whatever you want. If I want to repeat the drug, I would prefer to give 50 millisieverts. If I want to give one dose and leave it, I give one dose. Like carcinosin, I gave 1 mL, over. There ends the matter. So we have to be careful in selection of a potency. Posology, read Stuart Close. Right? Now, another magic of snake venom. Most of you may be aware, last time when I came to your Alwas Homeopathic Medical College, I have spoken about snake venom, Crotalus horridus, and the experiment what I have done along with the IACT and what we have established here. And you must be pleasantly surprised, we have now more than 42,000 patients registered in our JSPS college. And I might, my clinic itself in personal way here, I've got more than 2,300 cases. You can imagine, it is too high for any such type of magnanimity. Now, this snake venom Crotalus horridus, what it has done, it has prevented reverse transcriptase, Crotalus horridus 30 in the experiment in Indian Institute of Chemical Technology when we have done, we have shown to the world in in vitro study that HIV virus, which uses reverse transcriptase to convert its mRNA into complementary DNA, that reverse transcriptase was inhibited completely by Crotalus horridus 30. And reverse transcriptase is also used by DNA virus hepatitis B. In fact, RNA virus HIV, DNA virus hepatitis B. So why not we use in hepatitis? So one of my students in PG, she did a PG thesis also on hepatitis B also. This is one such case in the college when we have seen 25 year old man, blood donor. And when his blood was donated on one such occasion in 2016, it proved to be HBsAg positive and the blood was rejected. So then he came to us and we have treated, we have taken the HIV viral load, which was 14,413 copies per ml of blood. And LFT was normal, liver was doing perfectly normal. He was asymptomatic, there was nothing else. He came with only HBsAg positive. For all practical purposes, you can leave him. Oh, don't worry, leave him. But we wanted to see what will happen to his viral load with our drug. When we have treated him, you know, many HBV infection are unaware that they carry the infection. They give the blood, this blood recipient will also get the HBsAg positive. So there are 36 million approximately carriers. Blood transfusion, sexual activity, drug use, occupational exposure, so on and so forth. So we have given Crotalus horridus 30 and we have given the drug. Research I already told you in IACT we have done. And when we have followed with the crotalus iodus 30, CH30, and his viral load became zero. You can say less than 2.1 international unit or 5.8 copies, which you say as zero. WHO instructions would say that you should not say zero. That's the problem. Okay, normally left here. This is all comparison. We are waiting for HBsAg to become negative. Now, my friends, GIT disorders which we treat in and out every day, quite a number. But I thought, what are the commonest? And the young friends who establish the clinic in future, what are all the common complaints they encounter with? Commonly, it is the children who are brought to your clinic. And the mother or father would say, meethe goli, de do, humare bachcha bahut ro raha hai, pet mein dard hai. So, you have to give a meetha dawa, but it should also cure that condition. You should be able to understand what is happening. Or you are married, your son, you got a son, and the son is passing loose motions. What to do then? So, you need to be well equipped. You have to treat. Always I believe in one thing. As my guru used to say, if your family members don't take medicine from you, you are only 50% doctor. Right? Common GIT disorders in children. I'm talking of first children. That's what I mean. I don't want to deal with all the conditions in GIT in the short period. As far as possible, I try to cover. And I don't know, Sai Kiran, how much time am I given? How much time can you people bear me?
Till 8:30. After that, we have question session.
Okay.
Yeah. Till 8:30, you can continue.
Oof. Good. What is the time now? 7:30. Yeah.
Okay. 8:30, we can continue, sir.
Continue, right. Okay, but 8:15 for interaction we should have. 8:15, we'll see. Right, okay, done. Now, common GIT disorders in the children, vomiting, diarrhea, constipation, acute abdominal pain, pica. Pica, you all know, eating some nasty thing. Worm infestations. Now, vomiting, retrograde ejection of all gastrointestinal contents from the mouth, not from the mouth. It could be catastrophic, life-threatening also. We have to identify the cause. In a child, I'm talking of a child. I want to deal with two important major conditions. One, GIT in children, GIT disorders, and so-called surgical disorders in GIT. How do we deal with them? Then I'll touch upon some common ailments. Okay? I think you would agree with it. So we have to do the correct diagnosis. We have to understand if they don't have any serious organic cause, it will not lead to any dehydration or loss of weight if there is vomiting. That's more important. If a child is brought to your clinic, you should ask the mother, what is the weight loss? Is there any weight loss? Nothing. And you can check dehydration on the tongue. All those things. Then recurrent and severe vomitings will lead to disturbances of fluids and electrolytes. We should be careful. They should be replaced. It is a dehydration and it needs replacement as well. Occasional vomit, there is no problem. It could be acute fever or it could be ignored also. At the neonatal period, vomiting. I tell you, we used to have one of the most wonderful actors who became chief minister. His granddaughter was blessed with a child, right? I'm talking of NTR's granddaughter's child. She gave birth to the child, and from the word go, after the delivery, after the birth of the child started vomiting. Whenever the mother was suckling, so whenever the mother was feeding the baby, baby was vomiting. That point of time, you can imagine NTR was the chief minister at that time. So every medical doctor was available, all specialists. They have done every investigation, everything. And they could find that there is esophageal atresia. Esophagus was narrowed. It was not able to go down whatever the food or mother's milk the child suckled. it could not enter into the stomach. The child died in 3 years. Now, how do I know about this case? Because the girl was flown to London to show to geneticists, gynecologists, everything, all the investigations were done. And she flew back. Then she conceived again. And she was delivered of another male baby later. Now, the male baby again started having vomitings. Earlier also male baby anyway. Again started having vomiting. Similar episode, similar same diagnosis. Congenital, esophageal, atresia. So, at that time, after 5 days or so, the baby was brought to me. We have seen all that. Congenital, how much Hahnemann in classification of diseases. He writes, what are the three important classes at the very outset? Indisposition, surgical, dynamic. Indisposition, don't need to treat. Surgical, you can't treat, like this congenital atresia. We have limitations. Homeopathy has limitations in that condition. Dynamic, you know all that, acute, chronic and all. So here, congenital, I told them, it is difficult to treat, but I help when they said like, okay. Now there, we have treated with sifilinum. Basing on miasmatic pause, sifilinum was given. The baby, later I have given, in fact, carbovege 0/1, but the baby died on 14th day. Now, should I treat it as success? Because the first baby died on 5th day and second baby died 14th day, 9 days more. Wrong. We could not succeed in that case. We just gave few days of extra agony to the mother, nothing else. It is like I tell you in lighter vein, mother was telling the teacher, my son has improved after joining your school. How come? Yeah, my son in the last school, when he was asked, what is 6 into 6? He used to say 12. Now, how much is he saying? He is telling 18. There is a lot of improvement in this boy. Whether it is 12 or 18, both of them are wrong. So here, whether 5 days or 9 days, 14 days, doesn't matter. Anyway, so neonatal period, vomitings, atresia, meningitis, asphyxia, hydros, all most of the problems are severe problems. They have to be monitored in an institute. But as a homeopath, we should be aware that vomiting in a neonatal period is not to be ignored. We have to be very cautious and careful. It could be simple reflux, GE reflux, gastroesophageal reflux. You may give a bismuth. Bismuth 30 I have given to a child, a small baby in Niloufar Hospital, and the baby's vomiting completely stopped. It is not always, but we should be careful. Inborn errors of metabolism could also be the cause. In infancy, there is vomiting, pyloric stenosis, uremia, space occupying lesion, valvular small rotation, cow milk protection allergy, all these things. Gastroenteritis, of course, is easy to be treated. Overfeeding is very important. I have seen one mother telling me only one presenting complaint of the child, mera bachcha khata hi nahi. But when I have seen the child on the chair, he was having big lace packet in his hand and he was eating the lace chips. When I looked at the boy and looked at the mother, mother said, aaj hi kha raha hai. If he is eating for the first time, how can he take a big packet? So, this overfeeding also, which is very important for vomiting in infants. We have to be careful. In childhood, forget about all the serious problems. Simple urinary tract infection with fever can produce vomitings. Hepatitis, post-nasal dripping, maybe because of allergic rhinitis, there could be vomiting. Psychogenic, terrorized. Father is like terror. He's coming here and terrorizing. So he could vomit. He doesn't want to go to the school. teacher is beating, so he vomits. So apart from serious organic lesions, we should also think that there are conditions which are within our vicinity to treat and cure and make them completely all right. But a word of caution, first we should make the diagnosis, rule out the possibility of these many disorders which are appearing on the screen, so many. If there is space-occupying lesion, you have to be careful. You may treat that. Not that you should not treat, but take care. Diabetic ketoacidosis, it is serious condition in a childhood. It could be juvenile diabetes, type 1. It is insulin dependent. So we have to be careful. Intussusception. Most of the times, valvulus intussusception, intestinal obstruction, or surgical disorders, they produce acute abdomen. You have to be careful about it. Right? Now, this is a flow chart which will tell you how to make the diagnosis and how to come out of this. Mind well, we should never be blamed tomorrow that we made a wrong diagnosis and we were responsible for the death of the patient. We have to be careful. Vomiting, if it is with fever, it could be gastroenteritis, ASOM, acute ear infection, CSOM, hepatitis, CNS and other infections. If it is projectile vomiting, it could be pyloric stenosis, intussusception, adhesions, appendicitis. Adhesion, I tell you one thing. One young girl of 12 years was brought from Bidar having severe vomitings. Later on, the girl was operated upon for appendicitis and appendicectomy was done. After 3 months after the operation, the girl started having severe pain in the right iliac fossa with vomitings. And when we have seen the reports, we could come to know that it was adhesion at that surgical site which was responsible for this. And do you know what medicine did we give? We gave acetic acid. Acetic acid has got the quality of breaking the fibrous tissue. Acetic acid has got the quality of countering bad effects of anesthesia. It has both. So we gave and the baby became completely all. She did not require medicine later. If the projectile vomiting, if it is projectile vomiting is not fever, is not having, if it is severe projectile vomiting, it could be CNS infection. Or if it is fever with just vomiting, it could be growth or weight loss. If they are there, then diarrhea associated, gastroenteritis, food poisoning, common, ate somewhere outside, they develop. If other conditions, they are producing vomitings continuously and fever is also there, we have to rule out renal and metabolic disorders. And drugs and toxins should also be psychogenic, migraine. The youngest girl whom I have treated with migraine was 1.5-year-old girl. Migraine. Was diagnosed to have migraine. But here I tell you, I'll share with you whether I'm eating a little more time, but this girl was born to a doctor couple, dentist. Both of them were, the father was having HIV positive and he developed severe AIDS. He developed PCS infection in the brain. He almost went into comatose condition. He was declared almost like he would die in few hours. When he was being taken home, on the way, he was stopped at our clinic and we have treated that gentleman. And he became completely all right and it became negative also. But he pleaded with me that his case should never be discussed anywhere. So I don't take his name. This is all only between you and me. So no reports. So this man asked me last question, should I be common or normal with my wife, another dentist? I said, okay, you can be normal. They're expecting after a year or so, they will come back with report of again another Western blot, all these things. They did not come back. They came back after 4 years with a baby. That baby, this 1.5-year-old girl, started having headache. Diagnosed as migraine query. Before that, 6 months before that period, the baby was operated upon for malformation in the brain, and the doctor did not reveal his HIV status earlier to the neurosurgeon also. So they have treated, and that surgical condition has been corrected. Later on started having headache. Now, to all utter surprise, even utter surprise to me, when the whole case was taken by assistant, my assistant was telling, sir, let us give gelsemium. There are few indications. I said, let us keep quiet for some time. And the headache incidence was almost every day. I said, for 15 days, we'll give this medicine. I gave crotalosaridone 31 dose, SL for 15 days. And mind well, remember, no jokes. The girl's headache did not return until date. Even after 6 years, the girl never had headache. So migraine could be there, but we have to underline the migraine could be usually hemicrania and with vomitings. So we have to understand that. Okay. Now Murphy repertory, if you see food, artificial ailments from diarrhea and vomiting, natronfosin, nux vomica. Artificial foods, what we eat outside, pani puri khaliye, to aagaya. So nux vomica or natronfosin. Intussusception colic, then fecal vomiting, plumbum is the drug. Vomiting with cholera or camphor cuprum-berate, those four on top. Vomiting, curds, anything, even ethosa is a beautiful remedy. Food, milk, except they cannot. Okay, hydrasis. General milk after undigested, nectar. Now let us see diarrhea in children. I am talking of children disorders, GIT problems, and homeopathic management. Diarrhea. It is like passage of liquid or watery stool. More than 3 times a day. If somebody passes 2 times, ignore it. Don't treat. Just assure them. Okay? But the basic factor is recent change in the consistency of stool rather than number of stools. That is more important. That is latest definition. Persistent means some infection produces persistent more than 14 days. Then dysentery, presence of blood and pus. Then it could be rotavirus, E. coli, Vibrio cholera, Shigella, Salmonella, Entamoeba histolytica, which is very common. So thirsty and slightly irritable if the child is. Dehydration worsens, more irritable and pinched look. If the fontanelle are open, it is depressed, eyes sunken, abdomen distended in hypokalemia because the electrolytes are lost, passing urine in long intervals because urine production also comes down. If there is increased acidosis, breathing deep and rapid. Extreme cases, moribund, pulse weak, ready. BP falls, it should be very careful. Dehydration signs and symptoms have to be remembered. We have to check for that. Stool gas estimations, very important. So we have to take care of chloride, sodium, and ORT. In fact, WHO insists on ORT, oral rehydration therapy, instead of IV drips. So assessment of dehydration, anyway, skin pinching also, how we have to think of the alertness, how is it, and restlessness, is it there, lethargy, sunken, all this ORT has to be given. Sugar and food-based solutions can also be given, where salt can be added there. Electrolytes, very important. What are the important danger signs? Any watery stools, repeated vomiting, marked thirst, eating or drinking poorly, fever and blood in stool. If these are there, then we have to be careful. Probably institutionalization of the child is essential. You have to take care of everything. Right? So then the therapy here, what we continue, fluid therapy, rehydration, maintenance therapy, plan B, plan A, all the dehydration, then IV fluids may be needed in plan C where there is severe dehydration. Don't do it in your clinic. You have to do it in institute because fluid overload can cause severe damage later. Or fluid when it is being pumped into through IV may produce some problems, rigors, chills. You may require something to counter. Always it is better. Diet also very important. Then milk aggravation, diarrhea. You can see the drugs like calcarea, China, and so on and so forth. Then children diarrhea, podophyllum is first grade. We know aloes, children, diarrhea. But aloes and podophyllum, how do we differentiate? What I do in my clinical practice, if there are characteristic features of Maxwell, like scum on the frog pond or argentum nitricum, where it is greenish stool and severe desire for sweets, if these are there, fine. If they are not there, I would ask how many times, what is the hydration status? Then, how is the appetite? Appetite either increased or intact in case of aloes. In podophyllum, appetite is reduced. Rheum produces sour stools. Sternum produces extreme prostration. Acid fast will have diarrhea without any exhaustion. So will not come in children, acid fast. We should be careful. Now we'll come to constipation. May be defined as decrease in frequency of bowel movements and difficult in passage of hard stools. So intestinal, drugs, metabolic, neuromuscular, we have to see endocrinal, all these problems, they can be functional, they can be organic. Here, I'll tell you one thing in clinical practice. How do we diagnose a constipation? You have to probe. You have to be careful. When you ask, like most of the times my assistants would ask, how are your stools? Normal. So they write normal. What is normal? What is normal for you may not be exactly normal. One old lady was brought in the last week where she was telling, she was asking the question, my assistant, and the lady said, normal. She wrote normal. I suspected something. Then I asked daughter who brought this old lady. I asked, how are our stools? How about motions? You asked a very good question, sir. We have to request her at least once a week, please go. And she says, I am not getting. And she's comfortable. Feels better when constipated. What is the remedy?
Calcarea cup.
Fantastic. Very good. Calcarea cup has got, feels better when constipated. But they will not come to us. She came to us for some other complaint, but this helped us in prescription. Okay? But here in children, it could be functional, it could be organic. We have to rule out what is functional, what is organic. Constipation, albumina, bryonia, calcarea, lycopodium, noxonica, opium. Now, lac defloratum is another important remedy which is not given in your repertory here. That remedy can be a very handy remedy in children having constipation because of milk. Lac defloratum is one of the best remedies, you please know. Okay, constipation. Infants, artificial food means Cerelac, all those things which are available across the counters. If they are given, the mother has so much of work, she is duty bound and she is not able to spend time with the baby. So the Aya gives all this. Artificial foods, if they produce constipation, it could be albumina, natrophos, nuxworm. Then dentition during Magmoor. We know diarrhea during dentition, podophyllum, but it is Magmoor, constipation. Newborn children, newborn infants, zinc metallica. Then in boric, bottle fed, albumina, noxonica, opium. Abdominal pain, very important in children, very challenging complaint. There may be feeling sickness, it may be a true problem. Acute abdominal pain and chronic and recurrent abdominal pain. So causes children less than 2 years, malrotation, valveless, serious problems, or it could be pneumonia also. How do we diagnose pneumonia in children? The mother herself tells. What will happen to respiration in pneumonia? Respiration to pneumonia in pneumonia patients. Tachypnea. there is increased respiration, they take more number of times. In fact, 18 times respiration, 72 times pulse rate, 1:4 is the normal ratio. But this becomes 1:2. So we have to be careful. The mother comes and tells, you look at the abdomen of the child. It is swinging up and down so frequently. That is tachypnea, right? So that is one of the important points in diagnosing pneumonia in children. Gastroenteritis, UTI, hepatitis, and peritonitis. Then surgical causes, severe appendicitis, pain, intestinal obstruction, Meckel's diverticulum, so on and so forth. And medicinal, which you can definitely treat them. All the conditions listed here, they can be treated with our homeopathic medicines. Mesenteric lymphadenitis, if it is diagnosed on ultrasonogram, rule out the possibility of tuberculosis. Okay? Then approach, how do we, essential, time of onset, location, character of pain, which we always do. How do we make a common complete symptom? Other symptoms, anorexia, nausea, vomiting, and any other systemic symptoms, and family history also. Examination, child's activity should be observed, whether child looks ill or lethargic, rolling about in discomfort, alert but lying very still, abdominal. Now you know the colocin or MacFoss, they roll like this, they fold themselves and they press the abdomen. So your diagnosis of remedy is coming up, your diagnosis of disease also will come up. Systemic examination is very important. Child, if there are no specific findings, then it could be viral illness or gastroenteritis. If it is bilious vomiting or blood in stools, surgical cause should be ruled out. The child is ill but no specific diagnosis, observe. Non-gastrointestinal causes also should be ruled out in acute abdominal pain. Chronic recurrent. So it is defined as recurrent. Nearly 10 to 15% of school age children experience recurring abdominal pain. Most of the children who don't want to go to the school, they feel pain abdomen because you don't require any other investigation to confirm that. Pain abdomen, common. The mother herself says, "Arey, wait, so that's what like. Okay. Colic, malabsorption, milk allergy, rotational defects, which springs to disease, esophagitis. Then most of the time, functional pain in 2-year-old, constipation, giardiasis, abscess, lead poison, pancreatitis, urolithiasis. So then we have to understand localized pain, referred pain. Child gets up from sleep, there could be organic cause. Functional, child does not get. Sudden onset of severe pain, organic. High grade fever, dysuria, painful urination. Jaundice, anorexia, other physical findings. Functional, of course, non-organic. Psychological stress could be understood. We have to treat it very carefully and counsel the child. Ask the parents, what is the problem? Who is responsible? All these things, right? Colic infants, MacFoss, Naxmanica, Chamomilla. Chamomilla child, how do we make out? Very clearly, it is easy to make out. Always please remember, dear friends, if a child is crying and you are getting irritated, come on, stop it. That is Chamomilla child's cry. If a child is crying, you are saying, please don't cry. It could be pulsatilla crying. So we can make out the behavior of the child to make a diagnosis of a remedy. Okay? Then pain, cutting, lead colic, colocynthia is the best remedy. Earlier, the toys used to have lead, and when the children used to keep the toys in their mouth, the lead used to go inside and they used to get it. This pica is a wonderful perverted appetite. I tell you one case which was published in our National Journal of Homeopathy, for which I am associated editor. Now, I request all of you to become the subscribers also. It would be a beautiful magazine which you have to inculcate habit of reading And then I would also request the faculty and you, all of you, if you have beautiful cases, send it to me. I'll get it published in my NGH. Anyway, that apart, one young boy of, if I remember well, 11 or 10 year old boy was brought by the mother, and she was explaining, please tell this child, I am getting problems. I am getting nausea, vomiting when I look at him. I looked at him, and one day when he closed his mouth like this, I asked him, what are you eating? He was not telling. He closed his mouth. So, chori chukke kuch to kha raha hai bacha. Kya kha raha hai? Daantke, abusingly, the mother, in fact, bit him once and said, open your mouth. She could see a small black thing popping out through the mouth. Then she pulled it. She opened forcibly the mouth. When she pulled out, it was a cockroach off-eaten already. It is horrible. Very difficult to understand. Headstrong, adamant, pica, eating cockroach. What is the remedy? Please, somebody, some drug. Nobody? I'll give you a clue. This drug, most of the movies, when the heroine is cornered by the villain, heroine says, Bhagwan ke liye mujhe chhod do Bhagwan. But he is ruthless, merciless. He is pouncing on her. What is that drug in our Metro America?
Alumina.
No. Acid night. Nitric acid. Okay. You can read the drug in Metro America. You will understand. That is one of the wonderful drugs. It is a perverted eating disorder, pica. And etiology, it could be stress, maternal deprivation, mother is not there, mother died at a young age, parental separation, parental neglect, child abuse, nutritional deficiencies, especially iron. Iron deficiency, if it is there, most of the ladies do complain that they have a habit of eating raw rice, like alumina. First check for iron deficiency anemia, correct it, the pica will be corrected. Don't just give alumina, okay? And low economic status, cultural and familial factors also. If a Chinese fellow is eating some snake, don't say it as pica. That fellow has given us so much without asking, right? So, cultural and familial factors also very important. Alumina, first grade, see it here. Calcarea, nitric acid, okay? They want to eat sand, slate, earth. They have that desire to eat. Desire to eat ash, what is the remedy? Don't go to Shirdi and blame that gentleman who is taking that vibhuti and keeping on his tongue. Desire to eat ash will not apply there. He is becoming religious and he is taking that. But one fellow is eating ash. Veratrum. Worm infestations, which is common in children. The mother comes and tells that he is grinding his teeth in sleep. One of the commonest presentations. It could be due to poor sanitation, impure water, childhood malnutrition, anemia, common clinical presentation with worms, malnutrition, stunted physical growth, nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, perianal pruritus, which is very common. The mother comes and tells, he's keeping his hand at the anal area all the time, he's scratching. So seizures can also be there, cough and wheeze. Okay, you have many drugs like calcarea, sina, natrum, fos. The best spigelia also. The best nosode which keeps all these children normal is tuberculinum. That you should never forget. And followed by carcinosin. Okay? Now, the other condition. We were talking about the children disorders. How much is it beneficial to you? I don't know. But at least now, let us see this homeopathy in surgical disorders of the GIT. What will you do as a homeopath in surgical disorder? Appendicitis. One of my aunts gave me a ring and said, when I have pain in the abdomen, when I went to the physician, he took an ultrasonogram, he checked, he said, I have acute appendicitis. I must be operated upon. Clinically, how do you make the diagnosis of acute appendicitis? What are the three cardinal points? Anybody? What are they? Three in acute appendicitis. Pain, vomiting,
tenderness.
Pain, vomiting, fever. These three are cardinal features which are present clinically in a patient who is suffering with acute appendicitis. My aunt did not have anything except pain. I said, don't worry. I'll tell you the drug. Take the drug, you will be all right. Take the USG after 3 days from the same gentleman. The doctor got surprised of his life. So now, Hahnemann mentioned, what do we do, surgery? If you see, if you recollect, my dear friends, in Hahnemannian clinical classification of diseases, surgery comes at two places. On the top, indisposition, surgical disorders, dynamic. When you classify dynamic into acute, chronic and all that, there again it comes as surgery. At the top, Hahnemann says there is no role much for homeopathy. But here, there is some role for these conditions. It is supposed to be surgical, which can be corrected with surgery or post-surgical some complications, or instead of surgery, you treat. That's how these are all the conditions. Hahnemann mentioned in Argonaut. Surgery eliminates the ultimate of the disease and not its cause. This ultimate becomes a foreign matter, which is an obstacle, and the complete recovery is not possible unless this obstacle is removed. Hahnemann. So Hahnemann mentioned very clearly, it is better you insert a knife or do mechanical intervention. So wherever, whenever it is necessary for surgery, you may require it. But not in all cases. Okay. What is homeopathic standpoint? We know it is highly scientific, logical. Homeopathy most rational. And it is the medicine of future, what I feel. Now, when do we come to surgery? When the physiological changes cannot be brought back to normal position by medication. You have done anything, whatever is possible. It is better to go for surgery. When the part becomes irreparable, the fellow fell down, the bone broke into three pieces, your symphytum, your calcarea fas, your calcarea carb, your arnica may not help. You require, when a tumor develops, correction by the medicines is difficult. It is better to remove it. So, homeopathy is not against the surgeon. Mind well, the gentleman who discovered homeopathy was also an MBBS man. He has surgery in his degree. It is an art and science by itself, surgery. So, where medicines are limited or fail, then operations may be necessary. So in Organon, causa occasionalis, maintaining cause has been described by Hahnemann, and he says it is better to remove vesicle, calculus, all that. But it depends on what sort of condition are we dealing with, and how much surgery has to be done, and what is your role later. For example, in a case where renal failure has occurred, the damage has occurred to the kidneys, and the serum creatinine has shot up beyond 20-25, you're not able to bring it down, then probably kidney transplant would help the patient to recover and there is no life threat. Now it is your role as a homeopath to enter into the body with your medication and see that the kidney which is put there will not be rejected by the body, number one. Number two, that will be healthy and will run its course properly. So that is the role of homeopathy in surgical disorders. So individual organs are not the cause of illness, but disturbance at the inner level is the cause of illness. That is our concept of homeopathy. We have to take care of patient as a whole. Homeopathy believes in holistic, totalistic, and individualistic approach. 189 aphorism. So you can read that 189th aphorism also, what he mentioned about all that, what our organism deranged life can be settled. But in case of injuries, when those injuries are causing damage to the living organism, probably you may require a knife for it to be corrected. So we are not averse to those things, but not every time, every place surgery is advised. In fact, my younger son is a surgeon, but we fight. Okay. Now, when do we ask for surgery to come? Surgery comes, we already said, when the medicine has a limitation, when there is a physiological function deterioration, in spite of all that what you wanted to do, and tissues or parts are completely damaged, they have to be removed. Gangrene of a toe, it's basically a surgical disorder. But you see the history, my college name, Jay Surya Putti Sri Ramulu. Jay Surya was son of Sarojini Naidu, a famous pathologist, son of Dr. C.K. Naidu. When he has seen a small literature wherein Sekelkar cured gangrene of a patient, then he got fascinated. He took Sekelkar from the shop. He gave it to a patient who was admitted to his nursing home for gangrene amputation. And he gave Sekelkar and amputation was averted. So so-called inevitable surgical condition was also completely treated by homeopathy. It can happen. So there is nothing like surgical. There is nothing like medical. It depends on each case. We have to take that case. As Kent writes beautifully, he is a homeopathic patient or not, that is more important. We have to understand. Surgery may remove a tumor or a gallstone. For example, renal stone. Lithotripsy they do. Remove the renal stone. But again, there is a recurrence. Appendicitis, they have removed appendix. But the problem is still continuing because it is not confined to that local area alone. We have to take care. So homeopathic surgery is that form of treatment where the so-called surgical cases can be averted, managed completely, or helped in the pre-operative and post-operative stages with homeopathic medicines only. Hahnemann did not leave it untouched. He mentioned many, many references. In 86, also local maladies, he said. He continued to mention about 186 and all that. So, but later B.K. Sarkar mentioned in his commentary, what comes from within must be treated from within. And what comes from without must be treated from without. So that's how the basic sense he said. In a sense, there are some diseases which have to be surgically treated. We have to understand that. Severe acute abdomen, there is rupture and perforation of stomach. So it's a surgical condition. It has to be treated surgically. You can't say that you will give a medicine which will go and close that hole. But there are quite a number of GIT disorders in the day-to-day life which can be treated with homeopathy without surgery. So we have four ways: before surgery, during surgery, after surgery, instead of surgery. Case number one, if you see here, 60-year-old man, chronic amoebiasis, he was taking medicine. He was the regional manager for McDowell's. Oh, world of difference. McDonald's, we eat McDowell's, Vijay Mallya takes. Okay. So he never took other medicines except when he had a heart attack. That was also a big story anyway. So he had an angina attack. He was admitted to ICCU. Then they have taken USG and there cholelithiasis with 9 mm stone was detected, and it was a silent gallstone, but surgical gastroenterologist in the same hospital where he was treated for cardiac problem suggested cholecystectomy. But cardiologist has to clear it. Cardiologist said no. And the doctor also, sorry, the patient himself was also scared of surgical intervention. So nothing specific, nothing characteristic. His constitutional remedy was typical Nux vomica. He was a typical Nux vomica gentleman. So, and in fact, you should remember, I tell you about this gentleman who passed away 1 week back, unfortunately, due to severe cardiac arrest. This man did astrology post-graduation course at his 70th year. That is Nux vomica. Okay. So what should be given to this gentleman? Should I give Nux vomica 0/1 every day? Or he doesn't have any symptom. It was an accidental discovery. Cholelithiasis. What do I do then? So I have given colostrum 6x. We know sarcopenia. Okay. And when the USG was taken earlier, fatty liver, cholelithiasis, small left renal cortical cyst, and later, no cholelithiasis. Gallstones have disappeared with the help of colostrum 6x. It is possible. That was advised surgery. Before surgery, we treated, made him without going into surgery. Now we know cholelithiasis, rubrics usually, abdomen gallstones, colic gallstones, liver and region complaint, distension, flatulence. Best drainage remedies, solidago, which is also useful for renal problem, chelidonium, cordus, araxacum, hydrastis, chionanthus, chaena, myristica, myrica in fact, myrica. Myristica is myristica serifera for past conditions. Berberis vulgaris is also a beautiful remedy for gallstone colic. And constitutional remedies commonly indicated, commonly, at least in my clinical practice, lycopodium, phosphorus, sulfur, natrum, sulfalaxis, arsenic, sepia, and so on. Peltari, bilis, proxitasis, organopathic remedies. Painful spasms, colocin, diascoria, bryonia, camomilla. Ricinus, vipera, usually in cholecystitis. Sarcodes, all the extra. Then when surgery not possible, there is a gentleman where surgery has to be done but cannot be done. Like this case, usually in a palliative condition, terminal ill patients. Now this case, 54-year-old teacher, epigastric pain, right hypochondrium, dorsal vertebrae, 2 months, pruritus whole body, and yellow discoloration of sclera, jaundice you call it as, and then heartburn, water rash, used to take goli soda and other tablets also. Vomiting was also there. So he was diagnosed to have cancer duodenum, and it was causing damage to the local tissues also. There was portal vein infiltration. When they opened the abdomen and saw, they said they can't operate. So surgery was aborted. Tightness and stiffness in abdomen, aggravation after eating and drinking, ambulation lying on affected side. This was one such characteristic feature from homeopathic standpoint in this judgment. So cholecystectomy was done, gastrojejunostomy was done, paternal uncle died with throat cancer, father was asthmatic, spelling mistake. Then stools, heart, all those things were there, personal history. So we have taken mild desires, company desires for meat, warm food, yellow urine, pain aggravation lying side on, constriction. Lycopodium was the drug which came up. Sulfur, second choice, Natramore, Bryonium. So what to give? What to give? Lycopodium, sulfur, defect, constitutional remedies. It is advanced cancerous condition. We have to be careful. Even if you have an axe to cut a small thing, you don't use it. See the difference between a blacksmith and a goldsmith. A goldsmith uses a small hammer and does that tap, 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 because it is a delicate metal. A blacksmith uses a big metal. So there's a difference, the condition. So we have given chelidonium 0/1 and Natramore 6x, both together. And the patient survived for 4.5 years and he died peacefully. That's how we can give him. We can't cure him. Commonly employed homeo remedies in surgical conditions reduce fear and anxiety prior to surgery. Aconite, beautiful. Gelsemium also, or gelsemium or aconite night before the surgery, depending on face, problem, anxiety. That fellow will face the surgery without problem. Excess bleeding during surgery, arnica is beautiful, or you can think of arsenic, cinchona also, depending on their generalities. Ipecac, where there is thirstlessness, red blood, Sickle cord, black blood. Strontium core, shock after surgery, post-surgical hemorrhage. What is the surgeon's carbovage? We know carbovage, but what is surgeon's carbovage? Anybody? Strontium carb is surgeon's carbovage. Okay? Now, what are the drugs which will help recovery? All nausea and vomiting can be Ipecac, arsenic, they will help faster recovery. If there is constipation, arnica would be one of the best drugs to reduce constipation. Chaina, raffinus, it will be constipation with no urgence for a stool and painful gas in the upper left part of the abdomen. He says it is the gas is moving, it is very painful after surgery. Then raffinus is beautiful remedy there. Then carbovase, cinchona for if there is flatulence. Carbovase, cinchona also, chaina. Okay. Then colocin, raffinus also again for gas after surgery. Swelling, stiffness, pain, bruise, and soreness after the surgery. If that feeling is there in the patient, let them palm. Rostox, arnica, calendula, Staphsegria, abdominal surgeries followed by Staphsegria, they recover faster. After effects of anesthesia, I already said, acetic acid, phosphorus, beautiful remedies. To ward off infections, they have said in CDC in America, 5 lakh Americans annually suffer with Staph aureus conditions, surgical conditions. So, Ferrum Pass is beautiful remedy. If it is given, it will prevent any infections in the people. Now let us see some of the gastrointestinal tract conditions. I'll scan through very fast. I believe it is 8:30 now. We'll take 5 minutes. Jaundice, we have beautiful drugs. It should be 3 milligrams. This is the condition, icterus. You have to see in the white sclera. It could be hemolytic or it could be congenital. It could be hepatocellular. It could be cholestatic, obstructive. This is a stone in the bile duct. Laboratory investigations. We know USG scan, MRCP, ERCP along with serum bilirubin. Cholelithiasis, LFT also. Cholelithiasis, we have understood one case. Gallstones or acute cholecystitis. Gallstones in gallbladder, imaginary one. Obesity, old age. Rapid weight loss induce increased secretion of cholesterol. Rapid weight loss. The girls who try to reduce their weight faster, they may go for a risk of developing cholelithiasis. Fasting, total parenteral nutrition are the factors which cause impaired gallbladder function. Okay, now let us jump from here. Infections, and most of the times they may be asymptomatic. If it is asymptomatic, you treat with a specific remedy. If they are symptomatic, you get some conditions, then treat whichever comes in the list. Then all the investigations anyway, X-ray, abdomen, USG, oral cholecystography, CT scan, MRCP. These are gallstones when they are removed from the surgical intervention. Okay. And this is one like bile duct. Then cholelithiasis complications, empyema, pancreatitis, fistula, gallstone. We should also remember post-cholecystectomy syndrome. After surgical removal, they get the pain in the right upper quadrant. It still persists for some months. It could be functional large bowel disease. Then they get dysfunctional sphincter of Oddi. Homeopathic drugs, which we have already seen, colistinum, cordosmar, berberis, feltari, colistinum, again, China, lycopodium. Then acute cholecystitis. Here, patient, when he gets Murphy's sign, that is clinically very easy. When you press in the right hypochondrium, he stops breathing because your finger has touched the inflamed gallbladder. That is called as Murphy's sign. So we can make the diagnosis of acute cholecystitis. You should be careful, watchful. Just write pain hypochondrium, write hypochondrium, give the medicine and send him away. No, don't do it. Take care, investigate. That is my intention of showing this acute cholecystitis or acute pancreatitis. But most of the times they are acute abdomen and you have to be careful, cautious. Jaundice may be there, fever may be there. White blood cell also will be very high. Serum bilirubin also might raise. Amylase may also be raised. Then a plain X-ray abdomen, USG, they will detect very easily. Medical management is very important. Bed rest, because it is not so serious, not so fatal. You can treat it. That is the reason why we have treated quite a number of patients with that. Acute cholecystitis. Surgical, if it produces emergency, otherwise no need. And chronic, it can turn into chronic condition where the gallbladder thickness, wall thickness will be more and sluggish movement of gallbladder would also there. Stasis may be there, sludge may be there. Homeopathic constitutional treatment would treat this cholecystitis chronic one. Cholelithiasis, stones are in the common bile. It is obstructive. It can cause problems. Gallbladder might have stones earlier. Now the stones have migrated to this tract. You have to be careful. Some worms also may block. So it may be asymptomatic or there may be recurrent abdominal pain. Rigors may be there. Painless jaundice. So LFT values, cholestasis, bilirubinemia and bilirubinuria. USG scan, ERCP, they help in the diagnosis. Relief of pain, IV fluids, they may be needed and they may require surgical intervention. Pancreatitis, of course, it is acute and chronic. Acute, very fatal condition. We have to be careful. The moment you understand it could be acute pancreatitis, always better to suggest the patient go to a hospital. Treat, but go to a hospital. This is I get smashed. Is the mnemonic or the etiology? Idiopathic gallstones and all those trauma, steroids, mumps, all those. Then, in fact, scorpion bite can cause acute pancreatitis. clinical, severe upper abdominal pain. Pain radiates to the back also. Sitting up and leaning forward may relieve. Leaning backwards is diascoria. Forwards is, of course, colocynth macrophage. Fever may be there, pulse rate is high, and guarding and rigidity are usually present. Peritonitis. Cullen's sign and great Turner's sign. Characteristic features of acute pancreatitis. You can see great Turner's sign, and you can see Cullen's sign near the umbilicus also. Then the complications, volume depletion, and it can also cause filled loops of bowel, acute tubular necrosis, and it can lead to uremia also. We have to be careful. Cardiac insufficiency, shock, respiratory failure. If you see the list of complications, late complications, early complications, they will warn you not to take up acute pancreatitis cases in your clinic without caution. That is my intention of showing this in GIT disorders. Always, we cannot say everything we treat under the sun. We have to know our limitations also. In different diseases, if you see here, this pain at this area, pancreatitis, acute cholecystitis, arsenic cholangitis, perforatic. If the pain is here, appendicitis, cecal perforation, and ruptured ectopic also. Then ruptured aortic aneurysm, diverticulitis, bowel ischemia, intestinal obstruction. You see the pain in LIF. And if the pain is in LHC, myocardial infarction, or severe pneumonia. Then investigations, all these things, they are very important. Gallstones, all these things, very important. CT shows the edema also, normal pancreatitis, moderate pancreatitis, severe pancreatitis. Then treatment, management of acute disease, you know, rested. And we have to treat very carefully. Fluid therapy is very important. Okay, mortalities are more in 5% is not a joke. Okay. Then chronic pancreatitis is a beautiful condition to treat homeopathically. The most of the times what I have got in clinic, chronic calcific pancreatitis. So Calcarea group of remedies have helped in many, many conditions. Persistent inflammation, persistent pain, frequent attacks, and acute exacerbations here and there, now and then. So we have to be careful. Now we should know the value of that acute pancreatitis treatment. And at that time, when the person gets acute attack, you have to give. Like Iris Tenax is wonderful remedy which reduces the pain in acute pancreatitis. Like Iris Versicolor, Iris Tenax. They are very important in reducing acute pancreatitis pain. Steatorrhea would be there. Pain also, glycosuria, elevated IgG4. All these things, CRCP is essential for diagnosis. Calcification, you can see in the whole length of pancreas, all the calcified things. So it's chronic pancreatitis, all those calcified things. So complications, diabetes, brittle diabetes, which is uncontrolled, pseudosis, abscess, cancer also develops, exocrine insufficiency also, alcohol should be forbidden completely. Then you have to treat very carefully. Chronic pancreatitis is treatable. Conium, calcarea iodide, spongia, beautiful remedies, quilone, all these drugs. Boric, you can see atropine, iodum, iris, merthol, phosphorus. Right? Chionanthus also very important. Belladonna, all these acute drugs. Belladonna, colocynth, conium, chronic. Conium, colocynth, iris versicolor, iodium. What is the conclusion in pancreatitis? We will definitely see it if you are into practice. Very severe, 15% almost ICU admission. Mortality may be up to 50% in severe cases. We have to be careful. IBS is a beautiful place for homeopathy to treat. Irritable colon, mucus colitis. In most reporting patients in India, young men. America, women. All the investigations would be normal. They will get pain, altered bowel habits, alternating diarrhea or constipation. They may have dyspareunia, urinary frequency, and psychological stress is common. There is a Manning's criteria, there is a Rome symptom criteria. All these criteria have to be followed to make a diagnosis of IBS, irritable bowel syndrome. IBD is inflammatory bowel disorder. This is IBS. Okay, normal physical examination, all investigations will be normal, but the condition would look serious. That is IBS. Okay, so we have to be assuring him, tell him you can cure him. Take the whole constitution into cognizance and treat that gentleman, not just gastrointestinal symptoms. Crohn's disease, almost we have come to the end of it. Genetic susceptibility, environmental factors will lead to this problem, Crohn's disease, and they can have sclerosing cholangitis may be there, ankylosing spondylitis may be there, extraintestinal symptoms, and erythema nodosa, pyoderma gangrenosum. You can see serious conditions in Crohn's disease. And laboratory findings, anemia, leukocytosis, hypoalbuminemia, and colonoscopy usually is performed first evaluate. Typical endoscopy. Granulomas on biopsy are present in less than 25% of conditions. You can imagine granulomas could be there. So diagnosis, radiological interventions could tell you very clearly, essential in serious onset. Intermittent bouts of low-grade fever, diarrhea, and right lower quadrant pain. There may be mass in RIF and tenderness. Perianal disease with abscess. Radiographic evidence of ulcer. Ulcerative colitis. Most of my NRI patients have ulcerative colitis. I don't know why. Either the children will have atopic dermatitis, elders will have ulcerative colitis. What is happening, I don't know. I'm just collecting the information. Large intestine or colon, there is ulcer. And there will be constant diarrhea mixed with blood of gradual onset. Systemic conditions would also develop. It looks similar to that, genetic, environmental, diet, autoimmune disorders. So they will have blood and mucus gradual in onset. Rectal examination is important. Now extraintestinal features, aphthous ulcers, ophthalmic conditions, seronegative arthritis, ankylosing spondylitis, erythema nodosum, pyoderma gangrenosum, deep venous thrombosis, autoimmune hemolytic anemia, clubbing of fingers, cholangitis also. Lab, raised ESR, serum proteins decreased. Endoscopy. Colonoscopy should not be performed in patients with severe disease because of risk of perforation, ulcerative colitis, course and complications, flares of disease, it flares, skip lesions. Okay. So then we have to treat carefully. It is one of the conditions which can be successfully treated with homeopathic treatment. Antidiarrheal agents, all these things. Naxol. I have one patient, Naxvamika. He is a very leading lawyer in a high court here in Hyderabad, and he is completely all right with Naxvamika. Naxol, Mercor, Naxvamika, Colocin, Acidnite, Muriatic Acid. So all of you, thank you very much for your patient hearing. And I really thank Dr. Praveen, Dr. Sai Kiran, and other Roshan, everybody. So I wish you all the best. Now, if you have any doubts, any questions, if you have patience, I have a lot of patience anyway, you can ask me questions. You can unmute. Sai Kiran, you can unmute all the audience participants and let them ask questions. No problem.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Questions?
If anybody have questions, they can just raise their hand so that we can unmute them.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, any questions, please? Ansira, you can ask questions. What happened?
So
any questions, sir?
So
sir.
Yeah.
Sir, we are having questions from the participants.
Yeah, please tell me.
First question is, how can we manage GERD and mesenteric lymphadenopathy?
Right. Gastroesophageal reflux disorder nowadays has become very common. First of all, we have to rule out severe organic problem. Endoscopy will reveal whether there is lax lower esophageal sphincter. Then make the diagnosis and understand the condition. And all GERD patients are treated 100% successfully with your constitutional drugs. It could be argentum nitricum, lycopodium, mercurius, naxoamica, natrum carb, natrum phos, any drug for that matter, depending on their expression of symptomatology and their constitution. It is very easy. Mesenteric lymphadenopathy, if the patient is not having Cox abdomen, then Cox abdomen, your treatment is something different. We have to be very careful. If it is not mesenteric lymphadenopathy, anyway, you have to try to understand why lymph nodes in mesenteric area have become inflamed. There could be some infection somewhere in within the vicinity. If you are able to point out, fine. If not, the presenting complaints would lead you to a remedy which would definitely treat perfectly. I have treated at least quite a lot of cases with mesenteric lymphadenopathy with mercurius group of remedies commonly, but it is not compulsory. They would give us some other symptoms leading to some other remedy, and that drug will relieve mesenteric lymphadenopathy also. And in some of the cases, at least 30-40% of cases, I have seen mesenteric lymphadenopathy reported in USG accidentally without any symptoms at all. So it can be treated. Both of them are completely treated with your constitutional treatment. I'm not giving you the drugs names like mesenteric lymphadenopathy, gluconium, mercurius, MIRMF, not that. Any drug can be very effective depending on that gentleman who has the problem. Have I answered your question? First question?
Second question.
Yeah.
Sir, whether carcinogen should be given only in previous cancer history or not so necessary?
Absolutely not necessary. If you see the drug picture of carcinogen, one of the indications is past history of cancer or family history of cancer. One of the indications. Another one of the indications is saying during childhood, lots of infections. Another indication is saying parental museum of diseases, like father has got diabetes, mother has got hypertension, uncle has got cancer. Likewise, you ask the question, you will get so much of information of so many diseases in their family. Then you will wonder what drug should be selected. Better to give carcinogen because it covers all these things. But it is not compulsion. Yes. Third question. Have I answered your question?
Sir, next question.
Yeah.
Sir, cirrhosis of liver is treatable in children.
In children, you mean?
Yes, sir.
Why a child has developed cirrhosis? Was there any congenital anomaly? Remember, congenital malformations are not within the scope of homeopathy. Basically, there are certain conditions which have been corrected by so many homeopaths, but they are exceptions. But basically, even according to Hahnemannian classification of diseases, congenital malformations cannot be effectively treated with homeopathy. If there is a congenital problem and produced cirrhosis of liver in a child, it is difficult. But Indian childhood cirrhosis, there is a condition called as Indian childhood cirrhosis, ICC, that is treatable with homeopathy. Malnutrition would be one of the underlying causes for that. You can treat. Depending on the cause, childhood cirrhosis is treatable.
So next question.
Yeah.
Sir, can we treat diverticulitis?
Can we means can we cure it? If the question is, we can't cure it, but we can definitely treat it. I've got at least, if I remember, on hand nowadays, at least 3 cases. One lady who is 56 or 58. Other man is 62. So I have 3 cases which are running now, diverticulitis. And we are treating. Whatever symptoms they develop, we treat. We have not cured them. So we can definitely treat.
So one question from Sonika. Sir, how to manage hiccups?
Hiccups?
Yes.
Slap on the face of the patient. No. Hiccups. First of all, you should remember, what is the cause for the hiccups? I'll give you one small example. One gentleman was brought for only hiccups. 56-year-old man was brought for hiccups, and they were not getting reduced even after 2 days of common treatment and household treatment, all these things. Usually what the grandmother says, drink water. Somebody will say, if you are shocked, your hiccups will go. It did not happen. Okay. So this gentleman, who was a close friend of our erstwhile DGP in Andhra Pradesh, so he gave a ring. I said, you come down, I'll examine. For hiccups, why do you examine, sir? I said, hiccups, if it is not needed to examine, I will give you medicine. If it is to be examined, I need to. When I have examined, extracted the information, and he is a diabetic, he has pedal edema, he has other problems. When I have gone for investigations, he was having serum creatinine 15, urea 106 or 110. The uremia can also cause hiccups, which have to be treated in a separate manner. You can't treat with just a simple remedy for hiccups. Otherwise, Ignatia Naksuamika have treated innumerable cases of hiccups. Innumerable. If the hiccups were not getting relieved by any conventional method, I usually think Naksuamika or Ignatia, depending on that person's temperament, it will work. But always remember, as I gave an example of a case, you have to be careful in finding the reason. If there is no reason, the drug will relieve. You can treat. Yes, please. Next question. Any more?
Next question. Indications of cerenamine worm manifestation.
Indications of?
Cerenamine worm manifestation.
Cerenamine? What is that?
S-C-I-R-H-U-N-U-M. No, sir.
Cerenum is, what is cerenum? Carcinosin. Cerenum is the remedy, is similar to carcinosin, prepared from carcinoma of the breast. If the drug is prepared from carcinoma breast tissue, it is called as cerenum. Yes, my friend. So all the same indications of carcinosin would work in cerenum. A child who is timid, coward, who is under parental domination, develops vomit infestations, or the child's vomit infestations are not completely treated by your drug, cinnamon, santonin, chamomilla, tuberculinum, acid nitre, or any other drug, then think of carcinosin. That is the indication. Okay? And next question, please. Hello.
Hello.
Next question.
Next question. Abdominal pain of 2 years old child after USG abdominal, lymph nodes distended. What is the management, sir?
Lymph nodes distended, inflamed, which part of lymph nodes are distended?
Sir, they did not specify which lymph nodes.
That's what, that is more important. No, abdomen has got, okay, let us presume it has mesenteric lymph nodes. Okay. The same thing what we have discussed about mesenteric lymphadenitis. 2 year old boy also, you have to investigate, find out. Cox abdomen is common in some rural areas where milk is not pasteurized. Milk carries tubercular organisms and they get infected with tubercular organisms and they get Cox abdomen, and mesenteric lymphadenitis is common in children there. So you have to treat on par with some tuberculosis of lungs or like that. Take the case and treat.
Sir, next question.
Yeah.
Sir, how to manage intussusception with homeopathy?
Actually, plumbum metallicum gives the description of intussusception. Carbo-veg gives the description of intussusception. But intussusception, you have to be very careful. There may be stools in vomitus. So there is a severe problem. Intussusception means the intestine is going into this. Proximal part of the intestine is going into the distal part of the intestine and becoming almost like blocked. So then you have to be careful. It is an acute abdomen condition. It is so-called surgical condition. Though plumbum metallicum description or carbo-veg description says you can treat, but you have to be cautious, careful. Next.
Whether Robinia is good for acidity?
Fantastic drug. Robinia is one of the best remedies for hyperacidity. Natrum carb, natrum phos, Robinia, Nux vomica, Carbo-veg, Asafoetida are on the front line in the treatment of acid peptic disorders or acidity. Yes, please. Any more questions?
Sir, I think no more questions. Thank you for wonderful session. I hand over favor for saying vote of thanks.
No problem. Before that, I would thank all of you, the people who have listened, the people who have given their valued suggestions or anything, and the persons who have attended. Thanks to the management of Alva's Homeopathic Medical College also. Thanks to all of you. I wish you a very all the best. Safe. Take homeopathic preventive medicine for corona and propagate homeopathy all over the world. Right? Good luck.
Good evening, gentlemen and ladies. On behalf of Alva's Homeopathic Medical College, I would like to extend our heartfelt gratitude to you, Dr. Praveen Kumar, sir. For accepting our invitation and taking time out of schedule to impart us with your knowledge and your great experiences through this webinar. Thank you, sir. It was really informative session for all of us. Thank you and good night, everyone.
Thank you. I should also say thank you and all of you, all the best. Good night.
See you. Thank you so much.
Okay, let's meet again.
Thank you.